I once followed a sailing course, which is not really for me, as I am rather a fearful person. I still remember myself sitting in that boat, but when you want to sail, you have to be able to ease the rope. In a way, you have to loosen yourself. But the only thing I did was to control. I was in that boat, but even then I felt the fear I felt all these years, and that control. But it isn't right. It isn't right when you have to get on with your life and you are so afraid and you have to control. You are in a boat and you want to sail, and you are so afraid and you try. No, that is impossible. That doesn't work. Because once you have that diagnosis and people know it, the diagnosis will prevail. And that's a pity. Also, I don't agree with this diagnosis of bipolar anymore. Yes, I have been manic, depressed. I had a psychosis when I was 18. But for me, it's no longer a disease now. But if you say that to people, it is very likely that they will only look at your diagnosis. So you have to be strong.
This is a story fragment of my first session with Isabel, a lady who came to talk with me in therapy because things don't feel good anymore. When clients enter our therapy room, they always bring multiple self stories in different forms, measures, and colors. In this article, we explore how we, as narrative systemic therapists, can deal with these self stories. We depart thereby from the idea that the way therapists look at the self stories of their clients will automatically influence the way they will listen to these self-stories and the way they will work with these self-stories within a therapy context. But when we talk of the narrative self, or when we talk of the self as a story, what do we exactly mean by that? In the introduction part of this article, we describe the traditional and the postmodern perspectives on narrative selfhood. Departing from the limitations, but also from the possibilities of these existing perspectives, we use this article to experiment with an alternative Deleuze-Guattarian perspective. By bringing in their concept of the rhizome, and by considering selfhood as something that is rhizomatically co-constructed, we create an alternative view on the way narrative selfhood is continually formed and reformed within a therapy context. By creating such a rhizomatic view, with an emphasis on aspects as multiplicity, untamed story elements, ruptures, and also the possibility of lines of flight, we try to stimulate therapists to open up their looms with traditional storylines and to co-construct, together with their clients, creative patchworks of self-stories. In this way, temporal, local self-stories are co-created in different forms, colors, and measures, receptive to include constantly changes. She has been working on it for 15 years. Carrying about with her a shapeless bag of dingy, threadbare brocade, containing odds and ends of colored fabric in all possible shapes. She could never bring herself to trim them to any pattern, so she shifted and fitted and mused and fitted and shifted them like pieces of a patient puzzle picture. This article was published in Family Process. The main author, Jasmina Sermijn, works as a postdoc and a part-time lecturer at the Free University of Brussels, and also as a family therapist in a Hestia, an own practice. In her research, she focuses mainly on how the narrative co-construction process of selfhood is influenced by the dominant psychiatric diagnostic discourse. The co-author, Gerrit Loots, works as a full-time professor at the Free University of Brussels. He was the promoter of Jasmina during her PhD research. After she finished her PhD research, he stimulated her to continue and broaden up her research around this topic. If you have any questions, feedback, or you just want to talk about this article, please feel free to contact Jasmina on the following email address,